Good morning and welcome to our City Commission meeting. We have Pastor Clint Nelson here from St. Andrew Assembly of God to do the prayer. Clint?
Yes, bow our heads. Lord, we love you, God, and we just thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for your goodness, for your mercy, for your son, Jesus, who died on the cross for us. Lord, we see throughout Scripture where you've honored leadership, Lord, where you have blessed authority. And so, God, we just pray for our leaders this morning, God, that you use them, that you give them peace of mind, guidance, Lord, as they make decisions and lead us in direction, Lord, for this community. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Our pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to bring the seat down a little bit.
He's been waiting on that one for 2 weeks to say that.
I just thought of it. Really.
Yeah, okay.
Would you call the roll, please, ma'am?
Commissioner Nichols.
Here.
Commissioner Halagus.
Here.
Commissioner Brown.
Here.
Commissioner Rader.
Here.
Mayor Brudnick.
Here. We have the minutes from the October 10th meeting. We all had to get to read all those ahead of time. And
yes, Mayor, I have read them. And I think they're accurate, so I'd like to move approval of the October 10th City Commission meetings.
I'll second the motion, Mayor.
We'll call the roll, please.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am, even though I was not here. Okay, next we have... on the agenda, Triumph Funds request. We have a letter from the port requesting that we endorse them, I guess, by saying that, or they're asking for the city's support. We have not put together any plan as a city to be able to identify any type of project for funding for the city. I think that between the port and between, you know, them and Eastern Marine, that's two major game-changing situations that are going on in our city. We're very fortunate, and I guess everybody's going to be battling it out for to get their piece of the pie to help their business. So Mr. Stubbs sent us a letter and a draft executive summary for you all to review. And is anybody here from the port? Discuss it.
I think Wayne had to leave town. He called me yesterday, but he don't know if he was flying to Houston. Is anybody here representing them?
Yeah. So anyway, we want to show support for the port.
Yes, we do.
And make sure that they know that we're behind them, because that is, you know, with the new project that they've got going in next to the property they bought from the paper mill.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people they're going to be employing.
But I think it said 225 full-time.
Right.
Eventually.
And of course, we know that the Eastern Marine is going to be employing some 1,000 people, that they've already made a purchase to start their process. Started, I think they ordered engines already. So, real game changers for the city. And so, do we need some type of motion to?
Yes.
Okay. Is there a motion that we to approve the request of the port?
Mayor. Just to add to that, based on we had the opportunity last week to go and do the first pour, the foundation, which is a good event. You could tell that that port, the mill property, is going to be a game changer for industry in our community, which is great. And it's about I think 336 new jobs, direct and indirect jobs. So since we don't have any particular projects that are on the scale that the Trump funds are looking for, I'll make the motion to submit to the county as our list the Port Authority's project at the East Terminal development.
Okay. I'll second the motion.
I would like to second that motion because I, being a former employee of the paper mill, and I'd just like to have something to do with this.
Okay.
Very good.
Thank you.
Use his second.
I'll second the motion.
Motion and second. Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes. Devin?
The next item on the agenda is a request from Burke and Blue to amend its contract in two ways. One is to include a police services supplement, and this would be able to provide legal services to the police department in the vein of the action you've already taken in increasing the police officers by up to 17. This would enable the police department to have first-line legal advice, attending command staff meetings and doing other things on the front end of any issues that may come up. And there's a detailed description of the work that would be done, and as well as an hourly, monthly retainer. This is along the approach the city took with the Burke Blue contract to have a retainer, then that way we are available to handle anything without anyone worrying that they're going to have to read a invoice someday that they got a phone call from, they had to call the lawyers to talk about something. Natalie McSwain is a new associate in my office. Natalie was a 10-year police officer. She worked with the deputy sheriff down in Central Florida, and she went to law school, and so she's uniquely qualified. She is also an investigator to help and has walked in the shoes of the police department. So that's one request, to approve the supplement to professional services. The second is a request to amend the retainer by $2,500 a month. The first contract was in April of 2019. In March of 2014, switched from hourly to a lump sum. There was a caveat in that the city commission could reevaluate it at any time. Now it's been 3 years, and our request is for evaluation to increase it by $2,500. Also, we've added to reflect what we've been doing as far as getting much more involved in risk management, on the front end of issues. As employee issue comes up, as a claim comes to the city for any type of liability, that we're involved, and that has been, we went ahead and added that to the contract to reflect what we've been doing. So our request is to approve those two.
Your motion?
Mayor, I'd like to move approval of item number 5A.
Second?
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am. Okay, we have unfinished business, final reading of ordinance 2634, amending Chapter 22, traffic and vehicles of the ordinance. I guess that first reading was last week, and this is a public hearing, but before we get started with the public hearing, I want to say a couple things. I was out of the country and had quite a few texts and messages about this issue and really got into it, and I think that from a standpoint of a traffic ordinance, there are a lot of things in this particular ordinance that we need to get done. But at this particular time, just indulge me for a minute, I think that there was one issue here regarding on page 3, the use of skateboards, also prohibited in the area defined in St. Andrews. And I think that before the city takes on this particular issue, we probably need to look at skateboarding as a whole within the whole city. And I think that right now, I've had so many different issues. Okay, is it legal to be here? Is it legal to be there? Can you go on the street? Can you go on the sidewalk? Mm-hmm. And I think that with all those, this does not address skateboarding for the city as a whole.
Right.
And so I would like to, with the permission of the commission, to ask for a motion to approve this ordinance with leaving out that particular line. The use of skateboards shall also be prohibited in the area defined in the business district of St. Andrews. So trying to keep it simple.
Mayor, I would like to thank you for doing that. I don't know how the other commissioners feel about it, but I'm continually educating myself on, you know, on skateboards. I mean, as funny as that sounds, you know, there's a lot of caveats involved with, from the city's point of view, and it's not just a safety thing, but there's a thing of the, I don't know what you call it, the piece of metal that comes down or by the axle. Mr. Jeff, you explained it to me.
Yep. The truck.
The truck, yeah. Anyway, and you know, when they do the little tricks and things, which is great, sometimes it can cause a little junk in the concrete. And so, you know, but was not even aware of that because I don't skateboard. So that was a city issue that I discussed with Mr. Brown. So I think it's good that we pull this particular item and study it some more and understand that because when chunks are taken out of curbs or steps, you know, unintentionally, we have to go back and patch them, our crews do. So I just wanted to state that part of it, you know.
One other caveat, too, is there is very few, if any, public places in St. Andrews to skateboard now. So, I mean, I want to say that this is free reign to go and do whatever, but until we really get into this and figure out, is a motorized skateboard legal on the sidewalk or not? Is it legal? Because I've heard from one particular facet that you can do it on the street because it's just like a wheelchair. But I think that came from the wheelchair people or from the skateboard people. You know, from the other ones, you can't go up there. So I'm not real sure, but I don't want to pass something, you know, just with the one line that says something between this street and this street without addressing this issue for the whole city. So
I would agree. I don't like it being thrown in with this ordinance. Just, I like it to be a city.
It's too confusing. Plus, too, right now, we don't have, and this commission has looked at and staff is looking at doing a skateboard park, okay? Right now, we have no place to skateboard. So I'm going to tell people, you can't skateboard anywhere, and we're not giving you a place to do it. So we need to spend some more time looking at this.
Even with a skateboard park, I think that, if anything, it made me realize that I had no idea we had a ban downtown. If anything, I think we should go the opposite and consider lifting that ban downtown. The skateboards are like rollerblades and all these things. I just say less government, the better. I mean, I understand and can appreciate visiting this again and, you know, looking at both sides of it. But I think we need to figure out how to bring more diversity in, not push things out and make things so strict and so governmental. And if anything, the skateboard park is great, but like the downtown areas in general, could really use little small apparatuses around the downtown area so that they have a place to grind and to do those things. But there's so many kind of different kind of boards, like you said, there's long boards, penny boards, you know, but all of those things in general, like I'm very supportive of actually not only not putting a ban, but lifting the ban downtown.
So. Mr. Mayor, I invited two gentlemen to come in today, and they were very adamant about skateboarding, and they were skateboarding on the bicycle lane. So I stopped them in front of my house, and I asked them, why are you not on the sidewalk like everyone else? And they says that it's faster and safer to go in the back lane. But that brings me to this letter that I received about the gentleman saying skateboarding, is it recreational or is it some type of transportation? And I was looking at that, and I had thinking about that gun, just like Miss Halica, she done stole my deal again. She always do that.
I'm gonna let you
we
talk
think
first.
Alike. Yeah. But I was thinking it would bring in more, let's say, it would be a little bit confusing because if a man is using it to go to work, and most of the time, like these gentlemen was, they was in the bike lane. But now they're gonna bring in a new regulation. You can use a skateboard in a skateboard park, but you can't use it. So depending on the size and the type of skateboard, we're going to get into more and more demographics of how and what and when.
Agreed.
So I think we need to kind of, just like you said, I think we need to kind of look at it a little bit more.
Well, and also looking if there was any major safety issues. I mean, there's not that I'm aware of, there hasn't been any major safety issues. I think private property is probably the biggest problem, but we already have laws in place for protection of private property. So, anyway.
Okay.
You'll save me for last.
Yes, St. Andrews.
You know, with anything, when you do a policy, a lot of that comes with history. It's not knee-jerk reactions to something that comes in there. Why did that come about? How did it get to where it is? And so 2 weeks ago when the traffic thing came out, yes, it was a surprise to me that that they had this ban in that business district, because we really don't have an issue. Unfortunately, the media made it an issue. We've had problems in the past. I've been down there 11 years, and we've had some issues. So when you go back and you look in that two-block area from 12th Street to 10th and from Bayview to Chestnut, and you really say, where can you skateboard? There's really not a place for you to skateboard. So if you're coming down 11th Street and you're going to work on a longboard, I don't think we're going to stop them for doing that. But if you're going to what most people usually do with the skateboards, if they're skateboarding, not longboarding, or those electrical ones, then they want to find a place to jump. They want to, they want to do some railing. They're looking for those places to do it. So when you look at that two-block area, there's not a place for them to do it in there. When you talk to the people in the St. Andrews area and you ask them the right question, they develop the area as a walkable community. They want people out walking. They park your car and walk. We put parking lots on the back roads so they can get out and walk. When you put a combination on the narrow sidewalks we have, unlike downtown, a little wider, somebody's got to move. And unfortunately, sometimes it's the pedestrian that's got to move. So for understanding that there's no place down there that I'm aware of, the skateboard, I have no problem removing this. But I do strongly feel, because I worked on it about 2.5 years ago, is we need to put a skateboard park somewhere. And we probably knew we need to do it faster and sooner. So we give these young adults a place to go and do what they want to do on their skateboards. As I mentioned to the people downtown in the St. Andrews area, is somebody's on a longboard skating. They're not jumping. They're not doing that stuff. They're going from point A to point B. I see that. Which is fine. So I'm very comfortable on restricting that one sentence out of the out of this traffic policy, but revisiting it to the city as a whole. Because I had talked to a business person that's outside the downtown area that want to move their business in because they have some property damage right now because of that. So we have to talk about it, and if it's that passionate, we probably need to do a little workshop or, get up here and let's talk about it and talk about why we set policy. We set policies because of the stuff that we've learned in the past, not because we don't like skateboarders. I love skateboarders. I'd break my arm if I try to get on one, but they look like fun. I mean, I wish I could jump and do the things that these young adults could do. But we set policies because of stuff they've done in the past.
And that's why policies. You can't jump on sidewalks, though. So that was really two different issues, was walkability versus, like, the jumping and the skill set, right? Is that what you're saying, the two?
Correct.
Okay, because going from point A to point B would still be on the sidewalk, like, possibly, if you were going to work or something like that. But that's something, I'm cool revisiting it, but, just agree to disagree. So, yeah.
Well, I kind of will revisit it because there's a situation here, just like you said, the longboarding. And instead of going back into change the laws and change things like that, I would rather I've always said sidewalks is for walking, maybe wheelchairs or something like that. But that's why we have bike lanes. And when you don't have a bike lane, it's just like skating, rollerblading, things like that. Now, most of the people do that on the street, everywhere. They don't get on the sidewalks and do that. Motorized vehicles, motorized carts that some of these people are using to get around, they should be, to me personally, they should be in that lane, on the bicycle lane. But, hey, like I said, we'll revisit. We'll see where we come
from. Well,
I kind of more agree with
you. Just reinforce my point, because It's illegal to skateboard on a road. If you don't have a bike path, so that's why we need to revisit this, because we got to figure out what we're going to do to make sure that we don't confuse the public. So,
my exact thoughts.
Does anyone want to come up and address the traffic ordinance other than skateboards? Okay. Then do I hear a motion, or will someone make a motion to approve this, leaving out the...
I'll move approval ordinance number 2634, removing the line under section 22-5. The use of skateboards shall be prohibited in the defined area business district of St. Andrews.
Okay. Your second?
I'll second that. I'd like to add one statement, if it's okay.
Sure.
I appreciate some wonderful people that I've never really met, just talked to in passing, that are skateboarders. And they called me. And, you know, you only get anywhere if you communicate, work together. So I'm thankful for that. And I want them to know that, goodness gracious, I think all of us up here are supportive of building a skateboard park. That's been on our minds for a long time. And every time we think we find an appropriate place, we get the old NIMBY, not in my backyard, from the residents. But I think in talking with our city manager, we may have a place that's going to work. So I'm excited about that. And Jenna, I feel like we have too much government also. I'm with you on that. You know, I do feel like I don't want to put an extra burden on our police, and that's a major thing here. They got enough things to worry about.
Yeah, and I would like to say that. I do think you should be polite. I mean, but that's not a law, right? But if someone's skateboarding and there's a crowded sidewalk, I mean, to pick up your board and walk to the side, obviously. But anyway, all right.
Just common sense.
Okay. We have a motion and second. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes. Could you read the ordinance, please, sir?
Thank you. Ordinance number 2634 that was adopted with the one deletion of section 22.5, an ordinance amending chapter 22, traffic and vehicles, of the general ordinances providing for St. Andrews Business District. That is the section that has been deleted, so we will change the title. Providing an enforcement procedure through Bay County Clerk of the Circuit Court's Traffic Violations Bureau, changing division to section throughout. Providing that notices be sent through police department records section, removing issuance of complaint and warrant section, updating traffic accident reports request procedure, removing sections in conflict with new enforcement procedure, creating a provision for enforcement of parking requirements for persons with disability, providing that this ordinance shall be codified, allowing the amendment of city streets restricted for motor vehicles with more than two axles to be amended by resolution, and providing an effective date.
Okay, we have final reading of ordinance 2629.1, amending the future land use map, city for land use designation, general commercial property at 528 North Craft Avenue. This is a public hearing. Would anyone like to come up and address the commission on this ordinance? Yes, sir.
Excuse me.
Good evening. I'm John Tadlock. I'm actually the property owner of 528 North Craft Avenue. I was not able to attend the first meeting in reference to this. I'm a law enforcement officer, and I was actually deployed to Naples during Hurricane Irma. So I apologize for not being able to be here to speak at that meeting. But and from my understanding, it was recommended not to change the zoning of my property. I have a unique piece of property. It's split zoned. There's a line that goes not quite right up the middle, just maybe 6 foot off from center, which leaves me dead in the water. I can't develop it one way or the other, really, because it's half general commercial, half residential. What I'm wanting to do is have the entire property rezoned to general commercial. My intentions for the house that is on the property is to let a friend open a business for dog grooming, animal grooming. But I do ask that if y'all don't see fit to allow the property to go to general commercial, which is what I wish, I ask you please to at least let it go completely to residential, to mixed use. One, please don't leave me stuck with a split zone. That's my main request. I want to be able to develop one way or the other. Personally, like I said, I would prefer to go general commercial, but if not, I want to be able to go one way or the other. I don't want to be stuck with a piece of property that I really can't do much with, and I don't want to lose the $600 I've already spent in the rezoning process. But other
is that something that he has to reapply for, Mr. City Attorney?
Eventually. But Mr. Lane is the planning official.
No, sir. You guys okay. Had the right to make that decision today.
Good.
Oh, okay. Oh, the yeah. Change.
Good.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
Uh-huh. All right. Okay. So what's the pleasure of the commission?
I can't speak for the other folks. I'll speak for myself. I think we should honor his request. Are there any neighbors I should ask that are opposed to that are here today? I haven't had any calls on it.
Me neither.
I assumed it was all going to be GC1. I thought that was the intent originally, so maybe I misread it. So
The Planning Commission said that they did not want, it was turned down 3-1. So now he's asking us if we're going to go along with the Planning Commission, if we would please at least have him change it to mixed use.
Although it was noticed for GC1, because it would, if the board does, the commission does this, you are doing it as a less intense zoning, and it can be done today, as far as if you wanted to rezone the entire parcel at the less restrictive or the less dense.
Okay.
So just to add real quick. Planning Board, I guess, discussed it, and thank you for your service and going down there and participating. I know that was probably hard work for you. Is when you look at the map and you start getting back into the neighborhood and you're adding residential throughout, and the commercial piece is smaller than the residential part. The Planning Board did it for a purpose on that. I think we probably need to make it consistent and go to the mixed use and what the definitions under mixed use are. For me to be able to do that instead of spreading the commercial back farther behind us, because once you do commercial, even though, yes, it's a dog groomer, it's whatever's going to fall under that commercial use. So dog groomer today, heavy equipment tomorrow, and so these residents right here will be calling you, Commissioner, talking about noise and stuff. So residential will probably be a better mix of
mixed use.
So that gives you some flexibility as well. I want you to put there.
Let me ask a question, Mr. Nevin, with or Jeff, either one.
Mike.
Probably.
Thank you.
Mixed use, he could have his dog grooming business, correct?
No. That's the misnomer with mixed use one. Uh-huh. Mixed use one really should be an R3. It is a residential category. Don't know how it got started or how it's on our map that way or in our text that way, but it's really a residential category. It's not a mixed use at all, and that's what is confusing to a lot of people. But and here's the thing. This request is for a GC1, mm-hmm. Which is more of a less intense type of a use, which dog grooming is more of a neighborhood type use. It would also entail things like barber shops, beauty shops, that sort of thing, outright, instead of, a home occupation type use. Mm-hmm. But as far as, any type of more intense commercial use, retail or a gas station, no, that's more of a GC2 category, and that's not what this request is for.
Yeah. So what's the most intense commercial that he could do in a one?
Well, again, dog grooming is certainly more of a neighborhood type use.
What's like one of the more intense things that could be done still under that?
Restaurant.
Only if it's a certain size, a small little restaurant.
This is a small commercial deal that you're
doing. Yes. Really. And this is not a large parcel as well. So, that's.
But a bar with a back deck and a band?
No,
I mean, I'm just saying, if it's GC1, I don't want to get into
But number one, you can't accommodate the parking for that. So, No, that's not, that's not
allowed. What if they skateboarded over there?
They could do that in mixed use one, I'm afraid.
There's the location.
I think the mixed use one, probably the best thing for us to do here.
Well, he's not going to be able to have his dog.
No, he can't. Well, and to me, it sounds like the commercial's so small that it's not, wouldn't harm any residential in that area. It doesn't really
I don't think it will
sense.
Either. He's already paid $600. I mean, that's just me. Now, were you told that this is, you'll pay it and you may not get what you want?
I was told that. Yeah. I understood that was, you know, a possibility.
Well, he even said
to not.
Yeah, even with
you know, get it zone commercial. Well, that's what I would prefer. Most of the surrounding houses on one side of the property are general commercial, even though they're residential.
Are they really?
Yes, sir.
So,
one side of my property, they're mixed use. The other side of the property, all the residents and
Mr.
neighbors
Tadlock,
around.
Could
yes,
you?
Sir.
Could I ask you a question,
yes,
please?
Sir.
Could you come here a minute? I normally don't do this, but I've got. Sometimes I need to be shown.
Yes.
Okay, this right big rectangle is your
yes,
parcel.
Sir.
And these are residential units right here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and what are they zoned as?
They're zoned as mixed use over on that side.
Okay, they're zoned as?
All of these are zoned as general commercial.
But behind you is general commercial.
Yes, sir.
And that's why only half of your lot was GC.
I guess. It was zoned that way,
years ago.
In the 40s.
Yeah. So I understand that. I get that. So Fifth Court would be the only really, and part of Craft would be the only thing that might be affected on that corner, Mayor, if you look at that drawing.
Well, to me, it's the intensity of it. If the intensity of the commercial is really community-based and it's not from what Mike's telling me, I personally don't see what the problem is.
I don't have a problem with it being a general commercial. Did you already make a motion?
Nope.
No, that's just
okay, well, this is a public hearing, so if there's anyone else that wants to come up and speak on this issue, they need to do so when Mr. Tadlock sits down.
That's another thing. Mike, is there something you'd like to add?
Yeah, I was just going to point out if the board had the desire to help with a rezoning and allowing him to do like a dog grooming operation there, you know, we could settle for a mixed-use two type of zone. You know, which would allow neighborhood uses with, again, the mixed use two and the mixed use threes are true mixed uses. Allow for residential and commercial, and that would be another option for us.
Well,
that's
sounds
what
like a great.
Okay, well, see,
yeah,
that's
a great alternative.
I'd be fine with that. I think he would too. Wouldn't
yes,
yeah,
well,
okay,
that's
that
what the mixed means.
Yeah, but it's
the
MU1 is different than MU2.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but Mr. Tadlock, that'd be the best case scenario because then you could do residential or commercial.
Okay. All right.
Mr. Lane. Mr. Tadlock, are you in a rush to do anything in the next 30 days on your property?
The next 30 days, no, sir.
Okay. Since, Mike, you brought up another scenario that has not been presented to the planning board, you know, and you're telling us that, you know, and I haven't studied it, if you're changing it to another mixed use two or three or whatever. Can we postpone this to next month's meeting? You have a planning board meeting between?
We do, but you know, as Nevin had pointed out, this request was for general commercial one, and you can downzone, and technically you can go from a general commercial request to a mixed use option.
Okay.
And that way, you know, at the end of the day, the intent is solved. I mean, I would think it would be up to this board to choose if they desire to compromise.
What's a mixed use two then?
Mixed use two is it does allow up to I think 10 units an acre, which is a little different than the mixed use one. Mixed use one allows 5 units an acre, but again, that's not the intent with this parcel. As I said, this parcel is relatively small, and but the option is to allow more commercial activity on that parcel. So, you know, the interesting thing is about that neighborhood is that there are general commercial ones all throughout that neighborhood. And when you ride through there, they're houses. And, you know, they don't know that they've got general commercial one. But don't know how it happened, but in our wisdom in the past, we decided that that's what we wanted in that area. And, again, it just so happened that this was one of the parcels that we split zoned. We didn't take into account the whole entire parcel when we drew the map. So it's been that way for quite some time.
So you'd be happy with mixed use two?
Yes, sir. I would be happy with that.
Then I'll make a motion to apply to take staff's recommendation to turn it down for commercial use, but apply a mixed use two designation to the property.
And I'll second that, or anybody.
Yeah.
One minute. I think I read somewhere on this planning board on this day, the planning board did recommend that they make it consistent, one or the other one. I think I read that. So this will, we're voting on Mike's motion now, will make this property just one general area.
Correct.
That's the motion, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Well, I'll second the motion.
And that way, Mr. Tadlock, you will have more control over your property to do whichever one you please.
Thank and you. That's really what we're all about.
Yeah.
We really
thank you for less wanting government to do something with it.
Any other discussion?
Any other comment?
Any other comments from the audience? All right. Seeing no one, call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Thank you, sir.
Yes,
thank
ma'am.
Congratulations,
Mr. Tadlock.
Ordinance number 2629.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect the land use designation of mixed use 2 for a parcel of property located at 528 North Craft Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for a repealer, providing for severability, and providing for an effective date.
Mr. Mayor, hold on just a second. Mike, does it need to be land use designation of just plain mixed use, and then the zoning will be mixed
okay.
use too?
Okay. Oh, there's another ordinance coming up.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you.
We'll count that as a Scrivener's error.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. We have final reading of ordinance 2629.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 2 for the property located at 528 North Craft Avenue.
So I move final reading of ordinance 2629.2, changing the designation from general commercial to mixed use 2.
Second the motion.
Public hearing.
This is a public hearing. If anyone would like to come up and address this issue with the commission. Seeing no one, any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2629.2, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 528 North Craft Avenue, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 0.67 acres, mixed use 2, providing for severability and providing for an effective date.
Mr. Mayor, before
yes,
we get
ma'am.
To the consent agenda, staff would like to remove item 7A, the Girls Gone Wild. That event has been canceled by the applicant.
You know, when I first saw that, I thought it said girls.
I thought you just said girls. I hope
I
you
said
didn't.
Grills.
Okay.
And I
Lord.
And I'm going, I miss one meeting in 7 years.
Whoa.
And all of a sudden people are starting to do goofy
really?
Stuff. But okay. Anyways.
It's a pretty clever name, actually.
I sang for that 1 year. That was a good event.
Okay.
Grills.
I think it will be back next year. I think
good
the, from what I understand from staff is that the, due to the hurricanes,
look at Nick.
They're not able to get the participation
okay.
that they would normally get. So, and they did do it there last year.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a success, too.
So,
all right, so we have item 7B through 7F. Does the commission want to take any of those items and talk about them separately on the consent agenda? If not, do I hear a motion to approve 7B through 7F?
Yes, I'll move approval of the consent agenda, 7B through 7F.
I'll second the motion, ma'am.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
I'm sorry, just call the roll, my bad.
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
They canceled all together. Mr. Mayor and Commissioner, next item is consideration to enter into a contract with R.J. Gorman Marine Construction LLC in the amount of $211,908 for the St. Andrews Marina Floating Dock Project. This project includes a new wheelchair accessible ramp and floating dock for the historical Governor Stone and an extension of Marina Dock 6 to provide two more transient slips for 26-foot boats or larger. Water and electric will be provided to both new docks. The project was advertised for bid, and two bids were received on October 3rd as follows. R.J. Gorman, $211,908. H.G. Harder & Son, Incorporated, $236,832. Staff recommends award of the contract to the lowest bidder, R.J. Gorman Marine Construction, in the amount of $211,908. Also, this is funded out of the NERDA grant monies. So we will expend it and then get reimbursed back.
Okay, do we get the whole 250 even if we only do 211 on this project to use the rest of the money for something else?
No, sir. I don't think so because of the process you have to go through to get the project approved.
Couldn't get another 39,000. Okay, just wondering.
Move approval of item 8A.
Is there a second?
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion. Call roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, Mayor.
Excuse me.
Next, we have consideration for review and approval of the National Pollution Discharge Elimination System, or the NPDES, Notice of Intent to Use Generic Permit for Discharge of Stormwater from Phase 2 Municipal Separate Storm Sewer Systems, and the Fourth Annual Report. The city has completed the fourth year of this permit, and the notice of intent, which requires an annual submission summarizing stormwater pollution control measures being taken by the city. One of the elements of the annual permit requires the city to include into the regular commission meeting agenda an item for discussion of the NPDES permit report and other stormwater related topics. One of the elements of the notice of intent requires a $7,988 permit renewal fee every 5 years to continue the NPDES measures being taken by the city. A copy of their annual report and NOI is available to the public. Staff recommendation is consider and approve the attached NPDES notice of intent and RAI.
So in English, what does this say?
I know.
Essentially that we're reporting on what we do to keep debris from going into the stormwater system and eventually into the bay, and what measures, what projects I think we're going to take. Is that correct, Jennifer?
So it's a report that we submit on a yearly basis. Okay.
And for us to discharge into the bay, we have to have this permit for all our stormwater.
Okay. And how clean that water is. I mean, that's the whole report. Okay.
Testing and all that stuff. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Your motion on 8B?
Move approval of 8B.
Second motion.
Any other discussion? Call roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we have first reading of Ordinance 2625, which amends the Municipal Code, Article 7, Stormwater System Illicit Discharge and Connection. As a follow-up to what we just talked about.
Yeah.
The ordinance repeals Chapter 9-87, Illicit Discharge, and amends Chapter 12 of the Municipal Code to define illicit discharge and create procedures and criteria to address these discharges in accordance with the National Pollution Discharge Elimination System Program. So just as we just talked about, this now defines what an illicit discharge is. So if somebody puts something into storm sewer other than these things that are listed as permitted uses, then it is considered an illicit discharge, and then how we will act accordingly from that illicit discharge.
We'll clean it out.
Anything else you want to add?
That's how we'll act.
Okay. I guess. Right, you want to read this?
Yes, this is the first reading.
You got it?
I got it. Ordinance number 2625, an ordinance by the City of Panama City amending the City of Panama City Code of Ordinance Chapter 12 to adopt National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System NPDES standards to define illicit discharge, to adopt procedures and criteria to address illicit discharge, and for other purposes in accordance with the National Pollutant discharge elimination system program, providing for applicability, repeal, or severability, and effective date.
May I ask one question on this?
Sir.
Does this include Venetian Villa?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Next, we have consideration of acceptance of the Firehouse Subs Public Safety Foundation grant award in the amount of $7,050.25 and a budget amendment in the same amount with the accompanying resolution 2017-1024.2. The fire department will use the grant to purchase a forcible entry door simulator. The simulator will be utilized in training to help teach and practice the skills of forcible entry through doorways. This is a non-matching grant. The safety grant will either purchase the equipment for the fire department or provide the funding for the purchase of the equipment by the fire department. Recommendation is for the authorization to accept these funds and create a budget amendment in the amount of $7,050.25 and recommends the purchase of the forcible entry door simulator.
Okay. Hear a motion? You'll read the resolution afterwards.
Move approval 8D.
Second motion.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes.
Resolution number 2017-1024.2, a resolution providing for the amendment of the approved fiscal year 2017 budget for the acceptance of a Firehouse Subs Foundation grant and the purchase of training equipment.
Next, we have consideration of acceptance of the Department of Homeland Security's fiscal year 2017 port grant EMW-2017-PU-00057-S01 in the amount of $48,700 and for a budget amendment in the same amount with accompanying resolution number 2017-1024.1. The Panama City Fire Department will use the grant to purchase a compatible electronic system, lighting, and two portable radios in the amount of $48,700. These items will be installed on Fireboat 1. These items will allow the fireboat to operate in low visibility and darkness. The city is required a 25% match of the total grant award, which is $12,175. Staff recommendation is for the authorization to accept these funds and create a budget amendment in the amount of $48,700.
I'd like to move approval of this 8E, please.
Along with your second.
Second.
Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has approved resolution 2017-1024.1. A resolution providing for the amendment of the approved fiscal year 17-18 budget for the acceptance of a port security grant for upgrades to a fireboat.
Next, we have presentation by DAG and Associate Architects for the City Hall project at 501 Harrison Avenue. Owen Gibson is here to make a
good morning, Mayor, Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity. Just wanted to give you a quick update on where. I'm sorry. Can you hear me a little better now? I just want to give you an update on where we are with the design process. There's a lot going on. We started back in probably around the 1st of October by measuring the building. Since then, we've spent a lot of time meeting with each one of the users of the departments. I believe we've got around to just about everyone. If you haven't been contacted, just hang on. We'll get with you. But kind of, I just want to go through real quick. And again, I'm Owen Gibson with DAG Architects, and I've got Brian Spencer with Spencer Maxwell Partington here with me as well. And he probably want to talk to you about the concepts that we've generated. But real quick, we'll just flip through. Basically, we're just showing you. That's the lower level that you see on your screen now, that accounting, IT, and public works, they'll be in the lower level.
It's pretty hard for us to see that.
Pardon me?
It's pretty small, that. I mean, to see it, I'm sorry.
Okay.
You're naming all these things, but we're looking at it.
Okay, yeah, it is. You know. It is. And we'll give you some copies later on for you to look at as well. But the next level basically, again, shows you the various departments that we met with, potential city commission chamber. And then the next slide, the second level with the various departments there. So we'll, again, we've met with the departments, we've refined the plans, and we're basically getting close to going to the next phase. But basically the primary focus today is the exterior, emphasis on the exterior. The shot you're seeing there is what's currently there. The next slide, I think all you've seen, we generated four different options. What we're calling the classic, the tower, the contemporary, and the traditional. And the next slide, this is what we're calling the classic. So it's a brick option. Basically, we're tearing off the mansard. We're reusing the existing openings, going back with the brick, traditional detailing. The next slide is a contemporary option. Again, using some of the similar materials, brick and stucco. The next slide is what we're calling the tower option, basically brick and stucco, and with kind of a corner element to define the corner there at Harrison and Fifth. And with all these options, you know, we're going to be working with the CM to, in terms of cost, we take two options and basically a hybrid of two, just depending on the cost of the exterior envelope. And then the last option picks up on some of the arches, kind of traditional in this area. So primarily what we'd like to see if you can give us, what we need is we need direction on the exterior pretty soon. What we're looking at in terms of schedule is, like I said, we've counted on about 8 weeks from October 1st, and it's close to the end of October, that we'll have demolition documents ready for the CM to pull a permit on the demolition portion of the project. And then we've targeted December 1st to have the remainder of the documents or a good portion of it so that they can price and we'll refine it as we go along. But that's kind of where we're at right now.
Questions?
And we're going to be able to adjust those, I think we talked about.
Yes.
You know, even trying to could do a combination of the couple projects.
Right, right. Okay. But yeah, most likely as we go through, we'll take a couple of the options and refine them and come up with a final solution. But basically what we're requesting is, and I think y'all have had a chance to look at these, is to give us a direction. I want to go with possibly the one and two, or a combination of that, and then we can move forward.
I think what Owen's really saying is that we need to make a decision pretty quick so that they can continue to stay on their timeline.
Four choices. On that board that we looked at downstairs, a great big board.
Right.
And I gave Mr. Brown my top two choices. Did you write those down, Jeff?
Jeff wasn't here. It was Jared.
No, it was Jared.
Yeah, my bad.
But I think we do, and I don't know what that entails, if that's something we can just discuss, you know, whenever. But we need it. I would say that they need this, like, they needed it yesterday.
We have a very short fuse in order to get you. What we're targeting is get you in the building May 1st, and kind of how we see this going is between now and May 1st, we'll of course have the demolition accomplished, and depending on how the CM wants to accomplish this, is they can work from the basement or the lower level up. And then concurrently, on a concurrent track, they'll have another crew working on the outside, getting the exterior envelope dried in, the new windows put in, so that once you move in, they won't have to come inside of the building. All the interior work will be done. But after May 1st, once you move in, then they can come in right behind that and continue to work on the exterior. And then if you approve, then the third phase, if you will, would be the commission chamber, if you choose to approve that portion of it.
So when do we decide, like, how do we make this happen for them quick? Since there's not one that there's not one that anyone loves. They kind of want to do a hybrid.
Okay, so my first question for y'all is, Doug, get ready to be able to flip back here. But if you look at this here, is what Owen talked about, this has the arches to it. Mm-hmm. If you go back to number one, you'll notice that the windows are all square. Mm-hmm. So my question to y'all is, do you like square windows or do you like arch windows?
Are we making the decision today on what design we want?
Well, yeah, because it's...
The sooner the better.
I'll speak up. I like the arch windows, and they're already there. Save money.
Well, we're adding windows.
It'll be new windows. There'll be impact insulated windows. And each one of these schemes, we're basically reusing the existing openings and then punching some additional openings in. But we're going back with the original openings.
Okay. What? Just somebody lead us here. I mean, come
so,
on.
Well, so square. Census wise.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Are you? Because all the other. So let me go back to this. So all the other windows, as they're designed, were originally shown as being square windows. If you look at.
Go through the slides.
One,
like
two,
it.
Three.
Dark windows had character.
Yeah, we can flip through them.
So the question
that looks like
is,
a hospital.
See, that's
me.
A square.
So it does. It does, doesn't it?
Yeah. Like,
I don't even want to look at that one.
We can throw that one out.
Because it'll make it easier
for them.
For the design is,
yeah.
If we really can narrow down the windows today, probably, yeah. I wouldn't. That's mm-hmm. really the most glaring.
Yeah, there were really two things, right? It was the windows and the potential of the tower.
And the corner and the element.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the options, well, all three, putting the contemporary one aside, all three have similar elements, similar components. What we need to stress, though, is there may be, you know, I like the all brick option, but once we get into the pricing with the CM and verify our numbers, we may end up having to add some stucco, but kind of what we are looking to propose at least is have the brick on the pedestrian level and then the stucco above. But if we can afford it, you know, we'd like to probably like the all brick option.
So in the sense of design, when it comes to the windows, the square windows are more, you know, that's more now. Definitely more contemporary, that kind of thing. And on someone's house, they are way more desirable now than the other ones. But since I've been sitting here looking at it, I was thinking about, you know, the arches do, they still leave a part of downtown Panama City in that there's some arches, because the downtown is real straight. We don't have a lot of elevation. We don't see a ton of straight lines. That having that arch in there will kind of visually, I think, would probably tend to make it more attractive and make it, yes, it'll be a new building, and yes, it's new times, but at the same time, if we're trying to stick with the, you know, some of the historical look of it all.
It has a traditional historic flair to it.
But the tower, I think, is important, too, something in there, because it does add the elevation, too. It just looks cheap when things are just boom, boom, you know, so adding that extra elevation, that's just my opinion. But
I like that one.
I do, too. That's one. And I don't know about the tower is
spring for the extra brick. It's going to be here for more than a couple weeks.
Right, right.
So, yeah,
absolutely.
Isn't there? Correct. I thought there was brick underneath that stucco.
Yeah, they're over the years they've patched, and you really can't, you really can't match that brick. Right now on the front, there mm-hmm. used to be storefront. There used to be the old Sears building.
Right.
So you only have the old brick up above, and then once you turn the corner on Fifth, that first bay. There's only brick above. Once you get past that, there's CMU. So basically what we're looking at doing is framing outboard of the existing box, and in this case, you go up with new brick.
So we're not going to be able to
utilize
the old vintage brick?
It would be impossible to find brick that would match the brick up above, and two, over the years, there's been some openings that have been patched with CMU, so it would be a patchwork. And so again, what we're proposing is to provide a completely new exterior envelope and then apply the new brick or new brick and stucco. But
well, I like those windows, so
right.
if you have to adjust the building,
right.
But those are the windows that
I like
if you're asking me.
Yeah.
Yo, I love my brick.
I love the brick. So, this is just concept, so the brick color is not
No, the brick,
this
no,
is,
no, the brick yeah. color is not set. There's a lot of things. This is just concept only. You'll have the opportunity to review the brick, the interior okay. finishes and all that. And that's another component to it during this whole process. We'll put together a couple of palettes for the interior finishes. You'll have an opportunity to review those as well and select from those. So there's going to be a lot of decisions between now and when you move in May.
Do we need to make a motion? Or just the consensus?
Just consensus.
He just needs to know.
Yeah, if you like the what we're calling the, I believe this is traditional, we'll go with that and refine that and keep on going.
That's what I like.
Well, I would like to say, just to save time and make things, we get everything on time, I'll settle for that one. I'll settle for that. That's not the one I chose, but I'll settle.
Well, and like you said, we still might be able to tweak some elevations.
Yeah. Yeah, you'll have an opportunity to do that. But general direction, that's what we're looking for.
So that helps you? You're mm-hmm. set?
Good.
Good deal.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, there was an addendum, some items on the addendum that we need to discuss. And first is consideration of an amendment to the DAG contract for City Hall renovations. Initially, when the DAG contract was negotiated, staff thought the design of the telecom construction documents could be done internally. However, last week, after meeting with the architect, staff now fully understands what is involved and recognizes that staff does not have the capacity to complete the documents as required. DAG has contacted the electrical engineer to give a quote for producing the needed documents, and that comes in at $42,500 for the renovation and $6,300 for the chamber addition, if we go with the city commission chamber. And that chamber discussion will occur at a date in the future. Staff recommends the contract be amended not to exceed more than $48,800.
Your motion?
Yes, I'd like to move approval of staff recommendation on that.
Second motion, Mayor.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagas?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes.
Nevin, do you want to talk real quick about CM at risk and remind the commissioners?
Just as a refresher as far as the process for construction, the City Commission chose to go with a construction management firm. And once a construction management firm has been selected, then is a negotiation for a guaranteed maximum price. But just as a refresher, when the commission selects, this is the first time I believe Panama City has used a construction management firm. It's something that's become very popular with the school board and with especially the school board, but also with the county and throughout the state of Florida. Compensation is not a factor in the selection process. And the process of selecting is very similar to the process for selecting an engineer. I mean, it's pretty much identical. The job of a construction management firm is for the scheduling and the coordination of the project all during pre-construction and construction. And the goal is that there will be a successful, timely and economical completion of the project. So the presentations, it requires the statute that you have presentations, and in this case, the only two, well, there were three that submitted, and the only two that remained, because one dropped out, both made presentations. So in the presentations, you're to look at the qualifications of the construction management firm, their approach to the project, and their ability to furnish the services. And looking at the criteria is that you're to look at the ability of the professionals, look at their past performance, their willingness to meet the budget and the time, whether or not their location of their office is a factor to look at, their current workload and expected workload. This is our first construction management job, so there's not a volume of other work. And then, so all of these are factors that you look at in making a decision in selecting the construction management firm. Once the firm is selected, you then negotiate a contract, and then the contract comes back to the City Commission for subsequent approval. So I would just suggest that, you know, the staff has provided some information as far as the selection process, but that is the criteria for the City Commission to consider.
Okay. So next we have consideration of approving a contract with Greenhut Construction. as the construction manager at risk for renovation of the new City Hall at 501 Harrison Avenue. Staff received three responses to the statement of qualifications: GAC, Lord & Son, and Green Hut Construction. On a fast track, city staff asked the firms to come in for an interview within a week of responding. During this time, one of the firms, Lord & Son, withdrew from consideration. Representatives from GAC and Green Hut met with staff Thursday and Friday of last week. ZHA and DAG were there as well to discuss the project timeline and ability of the respondents to meet the city's needs. As we've talked about a little bit this morning, the city has made a commitment to the county to be out of this building in time so that the juvenile justice and family law division of the courts can move into this building temporarily, and the federal courthouse can move to that facility on 11th Street. So that's kind of where our time crunch is coming in. As ZHA's memo indicates, Green Hut Construction provided a thorough, detailed response and addressed project concerns with specific thoughts. Based on the interviews, submittals, and ZHA's memo, recommendation is to approve Green Hut as the construction manager at risk for the renovation of the new City Hall. In addition, we ask that you authorize the approval of $75,000 to allow some preliminary demolition expenditures. Let me go back and say this. GAC and Green Hut are both qualified under the rules that just Nevin just spoke about. And they are very well, they do their job very, very well. And I think we at staff would be comfortable with either one. I think the timeline maybe that we had to give everybody to respond to the interview process, maybe that it was just in that meeting that where Green Hut came out. However, like I said, I think GAC is qualified to do the work as well. And if they can meet the timelines, then from my perspective, I think it can work.
Well, I got a couple different questions. Number one, brings a question about us getting out of here by a certain time frame. We need to make sure that we let the county know that we need to start using their chamber for meetings.
Yes.
If that's the case, because that's only a few months away.
That is correct.
And so, you know, if in fact this federal courthouse issue comes to pass, I'm going to make sure. What kind of experience do we have with the other firm from Pensacola? Have they done any work for us?
Not that I'm aware of, no, sir. So let me address your question about the chambers. Bob, Mike, and I've talked on it several occasions about using that facility, and the county is on board with allowing us to utilize that facility in the random period if we need to. Yeah.
It's all about scheduling.
Correct. Okay. I mean, so much so that we've even had conversations with the two, with GAC and Green Hut, that our main focus is to get staff into that building. So that even if we have to, the exterior may not be completed by the time we need to get into that building. We need to be able to work around that so that we're out of this building.
Are we going to have some pretty severe penalty amounts if this thing isn't done by the date that we need to have it done by? I mean, it's...
Yes, sir, that's my intent, is to make sure we have enough stick in the contract.
All right. Comments from the commission?
Yeah, I just feel like my only concern, I always want to go local if possible. That's the first choice. So for GAC, being that they're qualified, I feel real strong about them giving this project as long as it can be done on time. And so when I called them to follow up about if they were going to be able to finish this project, if they would be able to do it on time, and they said yes. Of course, that's construction. But if that's the case, that's kind of how I feel about it. I would love to, you know, recycle the money through Bay County.
Well, Mayor, don't we already have a local preference ordinance that we've worked on before. Wouldn't that apply to this?
No, sir.
Okay.
The ordinance doesn't apply to this. However, location is an element in the statute when you consider
ranking an engineer or construction firm. We're talking about the same amount of money, correct? Up to $75,000 or?
Well, that's just for the preliminary demolition work.
Right.
However, the contract for the building will not be finalized probably until December 1st, probably at the earliest. Yes, I'm getting shaking up head. So a month from now is when we will have a price from just the construction manager at risk. That's the only one who will be, because they will now be on the project. And they will be our construction, our construction manager. So, but what this process does allow us to do is to look at the bids from the construction manager as well when we go through the process, as opposed to if we just did this as a traditional, we had an architect come in and design the work, and then the contractor come in and bid it. Only thing we would see is what their bottom line is.
The construction manager, and excuse my ignorance, but the construction manager will hire all the subs?
Yes. Yes, they will work for him, but we will get to see what those bids are.
Okay. So my question is, when the whichever construction come in, I'm looking like jobs local, putting the local economy to work. So with the Pensacola group coming in, that would be guaranteed so many or so much, a percentage of something like that of local workers to work on this project?
I don't yet know, because I don't know what, we don't know who the bids are.
Okay.
There's nothing that requires them to hire a local only. So I would assume they would probably hire, both firms will hire locally.
All right.
At first, if they can. But the problem may be is that, you know, everybody's busy right now. So we end up may seeing from either firm, somebody from Fort Walton, for example, that may come in, or Destin, or some other location, just because locally they cannot fulfill the requirements of the contract by the timeline.
All right.
Okay.
Or they may be running two firms at the same time doing the same kind of work, but on different floors.
But consideration will be in
yes,
the makeup of the contract, so we can may put these people to work that's around here looking for jobs.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Hear a motion from someone?
I'd like to make a motion that we give the contract to GAC.
I'll second that motion.
Right. Any other discussion? Anyone here from either company that would like to come up and speak?
Sorry, I stepped out. Bay Medical had just called me. I had a little family emergency.
So I got it. Okay.
No if problem. That's why, if I leave, please forgive me.
I'm Andrew Rowell with GAC Contractors, 4116 Highway 231 North. We thank you for this opportunity, and it will be our job to make sure that we go local first. We understand this is a high-profile project for the city of Panama City and Bay County, and we look to take care of our people first. It's going to be a tight schedule. We are planning to work around the clock, if needed, on certain areas of the construction, and we'll start with the demolition. We know that needs to be underway today, so we have a plan to start with the demolition in the next couple of days to at least remove flooring and ceiling tiles to make sure that we can stay ahead of your schedule to be in this building by May the 1st.
Thank you for that assurance.
Anyone else?
Just one question for Jeff, just real
yes,
quick,
sir.
Jeff, just that staff has looked at it, and you looked at GAC's qualifications, their approach, their ability to furnish the services, their past performances, their willingness, as we just heard, to meet the time frames, and you're comfortable with recommending GAC.
That is correct.
Okay. All right, we have a motion, second. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. We have, we're at the end of our agenda.
Public
comment? There's something that's not on the agenda today. Would you like to up and speak to the commission, please do so at this time.
Morning, Mr. Mayor, Commissioners. Brian Taylor, B-R-Y-A-N-T-A-Y-L-O-R, 1404 Cherry Street. First of all, I want to thank you very much for your consideration and the action you took this morning on item 6A. Secondly, I want to invite you all to an open house and dedication at our facility at 602 Harrison Avenue. We will be dedicating a portion of our facility to the late Peter Michael Bardock, and we would like you to be a part of that celebration. It will be Thursday, November 16th at 4 p.m., and we would love to have you all there. Thursday, November 16th at 4 p.m., 602 Harrison. Thank you all very much.
He was a great guy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Yolanda Stanley, 705 Hamilton Avenue, Panama City, Florida. You put the side, well, CRA put the sidewalk out in front of the house and everything, and whenever the commissioners came out, Jones, Jimmy Appleby, and Mrs., I want to call her Vivian, but it's not, Miss Champagne, Tony Champagne came. They told me they was going to put a sidewalk in front of the house, a driveway with the sidewalk, but they didn't do that there. They just got a sidewalk, and it's got a drop-off, and then when they put the sidewalk at the corner, they didn't cut the backwash off like it's supposed to. I've called several times. I've been calling ever since September the 7th and everything. I even talked to Mr. Brown. I even talked to my pastor. Everybody's been on the same accord. The city keeps saying that they go come out, they go come out, fix it. Nothing has been done about it. And it's a bad drop-off for me with my truck, and I'm tired of having a drop-off, and nobody's did anything about it. Every time you call down there, they go get somebody out there, get somebody out there. It's been going since September the 7th. And I'm getting knots in my tires from having to come off this sidewalk to the pavement and stuff. Yeah.
All right. Jeff?
I'll get with engineering. We'll go out there and take a look at it and maybe
and see about backfilling to the sidewalk.
They got grass at everybody's house from 9th Street all the way till you get to my house. Then just open. Then from 7th Place back to 7th Street is grass. Nothing is in front of my house. They could either put a slope for the sidewalk to connect with the sidewalk into the concrete to the road, or they could have put grass there. I mean, it's complete. There's just nothing. The sand has gone down and stuff.
All right. We'll get somebody out there. We apologize.
All right.
Anyone else?
Walter Henry, 614 Maple Avenue, Panama City, Florida, 3241. The project that she's talking about, I heard Mr. Jeff say he go get somebody out there to look at it. It's been looked at enough. What need to be done, it need to be fixed. I think I've brought this to y'all. I talked to Jeff. I talked to his assistant. His assistant get angry because the young lady called him. He do not return the phone calls. She called me, and I come out, check on why I had y'all not got back in touch with this young lady about the problem that she have. Come out, they don't have a phone number in there and showing anything where she called. I know she ain't just calling me to tell me this. Then secretary got in touch with him, called him, and he was in St. Andrews, but then he could call her right back. Then complain about to her, why did she call me? She would not have to call me if she do what he need to do, take care of what he need to take care of. Now, I work for the city, and the customer service with the city young got bad. Like, folks are not concerned about the citizens. I don't know why we have to go through that. We have commissioners that been appointed in these areas. When you talk to them, they say they can't talk to Jeff. Nobody can talk to him but the mayor. I don't see why. When you have all went through all the processes, all that you're supposed to go through, and continue to go over and over and over the same thing, why should we? You know, the citizens, you know, if they call, when I work with the city, they call I was there on point. Take care of what they needed. You know, didn't like what sometimes what they said, but they were the citizen. I looked at it, and when somebody called me today, anybody, about a project, I go and investigate it myself. I don't go by what they said. I look at it for myself. Where I can, when you ask me a question, what is what, I can tell you right off the bat what I have seen with my own eyes, and I know for myself. So I think the commissioner should have a say so that they could go to the, unless the mayor told them, you bring it to me and I take it to him. But I think they should be able to go and say, Jeff, these folks been calling, and they've been calling enough. Something need to be done. Something need to be taken care of. And that's what we are. I'm not out here to make anybody angry or make you upset, but we need to do what we need to do.
Thank you. We'll handle it. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else?
Judy Stapleton, can you hear me? 542 South Bonita Avenue. Hello again. I have to admit that I was a bit disappointed when I read in the newspaper Mr. Sonnenblick's comment, I and your city government agree that we need to triple the number of apartments on the marina. It made me question how much of the plan was simply Mr. Sonnenblick's, or how much of it was already being approved by the city. I just want to encourage you to listen to those of us who do believe that the marina is in need not only of repair right now, but also revitalization. But we don't believe in overdevelopment or focus on tourism. We care about our city, and we care about it as a place to live, to have businesses, for the business people's families, for our visitors, for our colleges. We believe in a city that is a great place to live, work, learn, and play, not for tourism. I don't have a problem with tourists. I become a tourist sometimes when I go to other cities. I recommend to you and others who are interested in the development of the city and the marina a website called Strong Towns. Some of you I know are familiar with it. It has some great reading. There's an article in it that was posted October 23rd called Desperate Development. We want to support you. We really do. But we believe in revitalization of the city and looking at livability for the people who live here and who might even want to move here if they visit. And we'd like for you to focus on that. And appropriately, according to Bay District Schools, today is Unity Day. And for those of you who haven't heard about this, I didn't until this morning, you're supposed to wear orange. I don't care if we wear orange. I saw that. But we do want to focus on unity. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy.
I'd like to say something to Judy, that newspaper article was the first I'd heard.
That, me too. So I okay, take offense. So, I take offense
I
to that.
I have no idea about that. That was news to me.
Yep. We're all surprised. We were very shocked, so please don't.
Yeah.
It was like, put yourself in our place. You wouldn't like it either.
Yeah.
So Katie knew before we did.
What is
that? Well,
I know. No, I know.
At least she added
a one. I'm just saying, you knew it before I did.
I would like to add to that, though. We had talked about the public information officer. Like, I'm only posting on my commission site because if I go somewhere else, then you're like, you know, people get all crazy. So. Is there any, have we thought any more about that, like hiring somebody, even if it was just for the marina project?
There's an application, yeah.
Yeah, they got 19
I saw a letter. Okay, so, great. Okay. So just so you know that somebody's taken the first step, which is great, because I did receive a letter or application or something about somebody interested. Okay.
Just want to get the right person.
Yeah.
Okay, if there's nothing else, we're adjourned. Thank you for being here.
Don't forget, we have a CDC.